The following presentation was made possible by the Alltech Media Group, a Southern California multimedia company providing exponential branding and marketing services to all their clients. The Alltech Media Group understands the value of the 3W strategy, providing their clients proven, trackable results. Let us make it easy for you to grow your business. Visit alltechmedia.com.
Our keynote speaker today has entered the United States Air Force in 1986 as an enlisted member of the California Air National Guard. He was commissioned as a second lieutenant upon graduation from the Academy of Military Science and continued his Air Force career as an undergraduate pilot training student at Laughlin Air Force Base in Texas. He is a highly decorated command pilot with over 3,200 hours of flying under his belt. As a fighter pilot, he has flown the T-37, the T-38, the F-4, and the F-16. Please join me in giving a warm Riverside welcome to the commander of the Riverside, of the 144th Fighter Wing Detachment-1, Lieutenant Colonel Mark Janksy. Colonel?
Cindy Roth called me a while back and asked me to give kind of an overview of 9/11, 9/11. I was thinking of starting out with a picture of me with brown hair and then see what you see now, but I decided to go against it. I'm going to give you a quick overview of what we do out here at March Air Force Base. Apparently a real quick interview of what we do. And what exactly we encompass our alert site encompasses out there. 144th Fighter Wing is actually the guard. I know there's a lot of military people out here. The difference between in the active duty Air Force, you have active duty, you have reserves, and they have the Air National Guard. The only real difference for the Air National Guard is we fall under the purview of the governor also, so we can do sub. You don't see a lot of pilots filling sandbags, but we're more than happy to if we need to. So here we are, 144th, back in 1948. We supported NORAD's mission. My wife gets mad at me all the time for spilling out acronyms. I'm sure all the military people know these. North American Air Defense Command. So. This is a quick alert history. Believe it or not, this is pared down from three different slides. It goes back and forth. Anyone who's been around here for a while probably remembers George Air Force Base. Fresno sat home station alert at Fresno since what you see on the date up there for 38 years, and they sat at George Air Force Base. That ended in the F-4 era when it switched over to California, or SoCal Logistics Airport up there. Fresno came down here in March. There's been some intermittent rainbowing, in other words, different units, and you'll see some of that as the slide goes on. Presently, we're at both positions here at March. This is our area of responsibility at AOR that we use specifically. That's the acronym we use for what we need to do. You're seeing Home Station Fresno and you're seeing our detachment. What we have, and you'll see these in the slides, 36 members of a detachment that sit down here to sit the air defense mission. Believe it or not, everything we do is based on nautical miles by statute miles, which is what you drive in a car. So everything will seem a little shrunk. We also go about 10 miles a minute, so we get to places a little bit faster. Is there any police in the room? I hope not. Because that's about how fast I drove here this morning in traffic. So. Believe it or not, with what you see up here is legitimate numbers in terms of distances of the coast from March Air Force Base. It's a fantastically placed air sovereignty or air control alert site out at March Air Force Base because we can cover the southern border, Los Angeles, San Diego, and then a tertiary. And I say that because Fresno can get over to, who sits alert, can get over to Vegas, and then over at Tucson also has an alert site that goes up to Vegas, but we can backfill if we need to. I'm sure almost everyone, if not everyone in this room, has driven to Vegas. I did it in 16 minutes, so if you can beat that, you're good to go. So you've got 35 miles from the coast, 45 from LA, 65, and then the southern border, and then obviously Vegas. The other important part is our home station, when we're in the same airplane, and that'll come up here shortly, is up in Fresno, and that's 210 miles away, and that creates a structure so we don't have to carry quite as much equipment down south. We can go back, reach back, and get it from the home station real quick. This is a 2001 manning, 18 personnel. There were 7 alert sites in the United States. It's not going to show you on the slide the day, September 11th in the afternoon, we spun up to 54 throughout the United States. Some of those were obviously not NORAD committed alert sites. I was actually DNF duty not to include flying that day, but I sat the SOF, the supervisor flying at March Air Force Base, and we had upwards of 6 to 8 aircraft flying over LA at any given time. The Navy supported us. I know there's some Navy guys in the room. Stennis was, I believe, down in off San Diego, and they were coming off that boat. We had guys coming out from Hill Air Force Base. Anyone who could responded. Little solemn picture here. We're going to have a slide because today is obviously 9/11, and the most important part of this is remembering what the gentleman up front here gave for us. We responded to the mission, but they gave their lives. So you'll see a follow-on video here.
Center, and that's all we know.
Today we had a national tragedy.
American Airlines Flight 11 departed Boston for Los Angeles.
Two airplanes have crashed into the World Trade Center.
Our World Trade Center has been one of their issues.
And now if you join me in a moment of silence. Thank you very much. May God bless the victims, their families, and America.
People were running their hair on fire. People were jumping out of the World Trade Center. Jumping out because they don't know what to do.
Walking on out.
People were most close to that. Just began their lives like children.
My children are 5 and 8 years old and their mother's still at work. If anyone sees it, then please call us. Please venture a call. Thank you.
Walk blind into the light and reach out for.
First time you people here have seen that. I saw that yesterday when I was actually downloading and setting it up, and that was pretty heart-wrenching. So, along with the people that obviously 9/11, the Twin Towers that you see all the time, Pentagon obviously was attacked too, and then the numbers down in the bottom corner are the people that seem to fall out, to include the United 93 out in Shanksville. After 9/11, the Department of Homeland Security was created to go after the terrorist threat that seems to come into the news every time about this time of the year. Obviously now we're dealing with ISIS or ISIL or whatever, IS, whatever you want to call it. any given time. The Air Force was the primary person who stepped up for air sovereignty alerts, now called air control alert, because we're controlling the airspace of the United States. Prior to 9/11, our basis was looking outward. We were the old Soviet threat, the Cold War era, and looking outside. Now we spend just as much time looking inside. By the way, this is an open invitation. Cindy Roth or Jim Mildotta have instant access to me, all too often, as a matter of fact. But you're more than welcome, anyone who's interested in coming out there to the base and seeing the fighters up close and seeing what we do. It's pretty fun and interesting. And along with that, the Air Guard operates 16 of the 18 air sovereignty alert sites that are in the continental United States. We have Hawaii and Alaska also. A few of those, the 22 had picked up some alert, but now it's coming back. It's a pretty expensive toy to be out there on alert. So we're sitting alert with what we call legacy aircraft, the F-15s and the 16s. This is our manning now, and it's changed. If you remember, the original one was 18. It's bumped up. We don't necessarily carry a lot more, but we divided ever since 9/11. How many lawyers are in the room? Okay. There's more and more lawyers, which means we can do less and less. And so each one of these people that can do three jobs can now legally only do one, but that's fine. So and in case you're interested, when I'm airborne, I am hot, which means I have live missiles, but again, I have a lawyer in the back seat. So everything I go through has to fall in place. No one's in trouble. So I'll give you a quick overview before I get the hack here of exactly how the command authority works in the United States. Continental NORAD region, CONAR, if you ever heard of that. Please tell me somebody in this room has seen War Games. I do this with tourists all the time, and they all stare at me like, what? And they're all born 2000 later, so it's getting pretty depressing. So, Continental NORAD region is CONAR. CANAR is Canadian, and then Alaska up in the north. That's based out of Tyndall, Florida, and they're basically one of those sets of lawyers that are now involved. The real people are down at the bottom, the Western Air Defense Sector. There's a Western Air Defense Sector up in Seattle, Washington, or just north of Seattle, and then there's one over in New York, Rome, New York, the Eastern Air Defense Sector. They are watching, and it's the same thing on the slide here, they're watching 80,000 tracks a day, which are requiring about 10,000 prosecution. Disregard 1,000. But what you're talking about prosecution is they're looking, they're IDing. And there's two different things, and I'm not going to go into the slides here, but if anyone flies in the room, there's two police forces watching you. Myself as the military, and then the AMOC, the customs on the other side of the house, are looking for drugs specifically and some other stuff, and obviously the terrorist threat now. So they're looking at those. If they can't figure out who it is, they're going to put us airborne. The 144th Command Post up in Fresno is now operating our command post, backed up by the 452nd, which is at March Air Force Base. And they're going to press the lights and horns, and off we go. And we're going to be scrambled immediately, faster than you believe. The mission types that we're doing out there are the NORAD, North American Air Defense Support, everything that I just kind of spoke about, peacetime air sovereignty. We can go into and take a look at any commercial airliners out there, the Payne-Stewart scenario, if you guys remember that, and obvious the repeat of the Payne-Stewart scenario that just happened a few days ago back east where the pilot got hypoxic. So we can go up there and see if we can get him to wake up, see if we can help him, obviously monitor his status and where he's going. Counter-narcotics threat, what can I do on F-16? To counter-narcotics, not a lot. I can get there real quick, I can get eyes on target. If he was a terrorist threat, we can make him go away if we needed to. We all have dual missions, wartime mission also going into theater. We're the Fresno fighter wing is in the transition. You'll see that now. It's in the F-15s. That'll probably be the question if there is one. We are in the F-16s, but our wartime mission is to go into theater and do offensive counter air there. The summary is exactly what Fresno's doing. Presently, I'm still flying the F-16s down in March because that's what we have. Fresno's in the F-15. They're going to come up on alert here at the end of the month. They've been backfilled by F-16s. And they're going to the F-15, which is the same age fighter. I like the Ferrari on the right, as opposed to the old Chevy the Ferrari on the left, the old Chevy on the right, but it is what it is. That one has two engines, so we're out over the water in the air defense mission that's looking further over the water nowadays. The two engines are pretty helpful. That's the important part of obviously what we do. I want to thank you guys for the opportunity to come out here. I definitely want to thank Riverside. And I am going to give a little plug for Jamil's museum over here because unbelievably, I've never gotten a noise complaint. I do some spectacular stuff over there, museum. So it's a great place to visit too. Riverside has been incredible across the board. I've been here since 86. I flew F4s till 93, and then I went up to Fresno for a while, and I came back down here. So everything we've ever done has been supported fantastic by the military. So thank you guys very much. And thanks for the opportunity to speak.